So in the previous classes, we had looked into few concepts where we could set the cutoff frequency. The reason why we were using this kind of setting was because if we had to make some changes to the impedance, then it was possible for us to do it. And we were actually taking the help of the capacitor here, which is connected at the fe in the feedback loop. Right, and we termed this capacitor as CF. Right, so with the help of this capacitor, the values of impedance could be changed, and we could actually set the cutoff frequency. So the reason why we are doing it is because if we are interested in a certain band of frequencies, we can concentrate on that, and the rest of the frequencies can be eliminated. Right, so this was the whole idea of getting or setting the upper cutoff frequency with the help of capacitor CF, right? So having understood that concept, so today we'll be looking into single polarity. Now, in my previous lectures, I've mentioned exclusively that if in case we are using a single polarity power supply, then it should be proportionate. Okay, so when I say proportionate, okay, if in case it is specified as 18 volts, okay, then I need to have with the help of these R1 and R2, it's going to be a voltage divider, then plus 9 and minus 9 would come in here. Okay, so we will look at these concepts one by one, and we'll try and understand how this single polarity concept can be used. Okay, fine. So capacitor coupled op-amp circuits can be easily adapted to use a single polarity supply voltage because the capacitors block DC, right? So we have learned throughout that capacitors always block DC voltages at the input and output. So which means wherever you have capacitors, if you place them at the input side, then the DCs are blocked, and then if you placed it at the output side, then DCs at the output side are blocked. So ultimately, we are looking at blocking of DC signals. When I say capacitor coupled, keep in mind that you will not have only capacitors at the input side, but then you will have these capacitors even at the output side. Okay, so they are termed as C1 and C2. If the op-amp data sheet, okay, lists the minimum supply voltage as plus or minus 9 volt, then a minimum of 18 volts should be used in a single polarity supply. Okay, so if we have to use 9 volts, if the specification says that it is to have plus 9 and minus 9, so in that case, okay, here since it is only single polarity, so what I have to do is I have to give double the amount. Why am I doing double the amount? Because I have these resistors here, right? So these resistors are acting as voltage divider, as we all have seen previously. R1 and R2 is acting as voltage divider. So when I give 18 volts here, so plus 9 and minus 9 equally comes. So you can see that we have a VCC by 2, and this is possible only by having R1 and R2 combination, and this combination works as voltage divider. Fine. So the next one, that we'll be seeing is the specified maximum supply voltage must not be exceeded. So whatever is the voltage told, only that should be used. Like for example, here we have seen that it needs plus 9 volts. So instead of that, if I give about 20 volts, then what is going to happen? I'm going to get 10 plus 10 here and minus 10 here. So this should not be done. Okay. Whatever is told, only that should be followed. The specified maximum supply should be followed. Voltage divider R1 and R2 sets the bias voltage at the non-inverting input terminal as approximately VCC by 2. So this VCC by 2 concept is very important. How much ever VCC you are giving, it is getting divided by 2. So this is not only called VCC by 2, but then it's also termed as voltage divider concept. Okay, so if I need 9, then approximately I'll have to give about 18. I should not give 17, I should not give 19. Exactly 18 should be given. Okay, so this VS should be 18. Okay, it means the DC levels of the op-amp output terminal and the inverting input are also at VCC by 2. So two things here, right? Now we have to get back to the concept in which we had studied previously. So the DC levels of op-amp output and inverting input are also at VCC by 2. Can someone tell me how is it possible? How is it possible that output also has the same thing and the inverting input also has the same thing, which is VCC by 2? How is it possible? Yeah, students, how is it possible? Recalling the concept of, you know, the property of op-amp. Okay, so whatever inputs that you give here, okay, at the non-inverting terminal, the same thing will be across your inverting terminal. And inputs, whatever inputs are given, the same thing will appear at the outputs. So keeping this property in mind, okay, we know that we are giving 18 volts here. So plus 9 is coming here, minus 9 will be available here. So we are seeing that the op-amp output terminal and inverting input, that is at minus, will also remain the same, which is at VCC by 2. So if in case I'm giving 20, then it's going to be 10 at, you know, non-inverting, inverting, and the output. Because see, it's a feedback loop, right? Thus, with an 18 volt supply, the positive supply terminal is plus 9 with respect to bias level at the input, and output terminals and the negative supply terminal is minus 9 with respect to those terminals. So those terminals means what? Bias level. Now, can someone tell me what is a bias? What's a bias? What is bias?
The supply we give, sir.
Yeah, the supply we give in order to turn on the system. Okay. In order to turn on the system and make the system functional. So here our system is circuit. Okay. So having understood these concepts, we will move on with the other concepts. So the voltage divider resistors are determined in the usual way. Now we have certain rules, right? If the capacitor is low, then if it has a low value, then I'll be having a resistor of higher value, right? So we have learned about this, and we have also learned that, you know, this I2 is going to be very large compared to the bias current. Okay. The voltage divider circuit resistors are determined in the usual way by choosing a resistor current I2 very much larger than the op-amp input bias current. So a large current is actually chosen, that is I2, compared to the bias current, which is IB max. If you can remember, we had seen this IB max and we had seen this in, you know, the specifications. The characteristics of an op-amp, let's say for example 741, then we'll be looking at, you know, the IB max values of that specification. Okay, the voltage drop across each resistor is usually selected at VCC by 2. Now why is it VCC by 2? We have learned that it is a voltage divider. Although it could be above or below this point within the specified input range for the op-amp. The input impedance of the circuit in figure A. So we are now looking at figure A only as of now. Okay, as of now at figure A is Zn is equal to R1 in parallel with R2. So yeah, we have seen this formula as well previously. So as usual, XE1, so what we do is, you know, we have R1 divided by 10. Usually we used to take that concept, but right now I have two resistors, R1 and R2. So since they are in parallel combination, I come up with a single value of this resistor. And how do I do that? I use the formula R1 is in parallel with R2. So I get a single value here, and that is divided by 10. So that's the impedance of capacitor C1. And at X2, it is dependent on resistor RL. Okay, so we have seen these two formulas as well. See, most of the concepts that you have studied will be re-implemented and explained in a different dimension. The only thing that you will have to do is, you know, probably make some changes to the circuit and explain it accordingly. Fine. Now let's concentrate on figure B, right? So in this figure B, you know, you can see that it's a high input impedance capacitor, which is capacitor coupled voltage follower using single polarity. Okay, using single polarity. So let's focus on this diagram now. Okay, figure B shows a high input impedance voltage follower using a single polarity supply. So previously, you know, we were actually, you know, capacitor coupled voltage follower, we were giving it here. Okay, but right now what we have done is, you know, we have made some changes here. Plus VCC we are giving here, and then I am actually putting an additional capacitor here. See, here you cannot find any capacitor in your figure A, but here I'm having a capacitor, and additional resistor R3 is added. Okay, so RL remains as it is. Okay, instead of C2 it is C3 here, and this is the extra capacitance plus VCC minus VE, and C1 as usual. Okay, so we have an extra resistor and an extra capacitor. Here also R1 and R2 forms a parallel combination, which means this is also acting as VCC by 2. Okay. Right. So voltage divider R1 and R2 again serve to set the bias voltage at approximately VCC by 2. So you can see that here, right? R1 and R2. So these two are, you know, voltage divider, and approximately it's going to be VCC by 2. What is this VCC by 2? As we discussed previously, if I need the potential to be at plus or minus 9, then I'm going to give the supply as, you know, VCC is going to be 18, exactly the double of it. Resistor R3 is now included. So we have this extra resistor, which is R3, and its bottom end may be pushed up and pushed down by the feedback via C2. So you can find that, you know, it has its bottom end connected here with the junction R1 and C2. R1 resistor is here, C2 is one of its terminals is here, and this R3, the bottom end of R3, is connected here. So if in case there is a change in output, so anyway, we are taking it as a feedback. So this capacitor is, you know, we can also call it as a feedback capacitor C2, right? And this will make changes here to this junction, and accordingly, the one of the terminal of R3 values are also going to get changed. So which means now if I have to calculate the gain, okay, then it's going to be 1 plus AOL into R3, okay, because R1 and R2 is forming a parallel combination, and this feedback, okay, is actually very much related to R3 because one of its terminals are connected here. Resistor R3 is now included so that its bottom end may be pushed up and down by feedback via C2, okay. So if I have to, you know, see the formula, right? So this is going to be my formula, which is 1 plus AOL into R3. Okay. So keep noting these formulas. You'll be needing this for solving your problems. In this circuit, right, we are looking at figure B. In this circuit, the resistance in series with C2 is R1 and R2. So this is again in parallel combination. Okay, the top of R1, which means we are talking at with this terminal, okay, the top of R1 is AC grounded via VCC. So this, why I am telling it is grounded via VCC is because, you know, we are actually calculating it with respect to ground. VCC with respect to ground. Okay, so R1 is AC grounded via VCC. So C2 is calculated. So how do I calculate the value of C2? So in your problems, if you have, you know, to calculate the values of C2 and the other values are given, right? So this is going to be your formula. Okay, so R1, R2 is in parallel combination and that is divided by 10. So always these coupling capacitors, okay, will be dependent on these resistors R1 and R2, which is at the input side. R3 is dependent with the feedback, okay, with the feedback. So which means it is dependent heavily with the gain, okay, with the gain. Any doubts here, students? Is it all fine? Any doubts, you can feel free to ask. Yes?
No.
Can I proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So most of the design concepts that we see, right, are going to be more or less the same. Like, you know, for example, XC2, which is if that coupling capacitor is at the output side, then it's going to be dependent on RL, right? So if it's going to be at the input side, then it's going to be dependent on R1 and R2. So R1, R2 divided by 10. So R1, R2 here are in parallel combination, right? Okay. Now we will look at non-inverting amplifier. Okay, so far we were looking into both of the configurations in voltage follower. Voltage follower, why do we call it? Because whatever is the output, okay, is actually following the values of input. So output is following input. So we term it as voltage follower. Here, we are again continuing the concept with single polarity, right? So which means how the single polarity is used with respect to non-inverting amplifier. So the same concept here. If I'm using a single polarity, then if the voltage levels are to be, you know, about 20 volts, okay. If the op-amp meets plus 10 and minus 10, then I'm going to use plus 20, right? So because that is going to be, you know, divided by 2 just because of this combination of R1 and R2. So that's going to give me VCC by 2, right? So let's now concentrate on this figure A. Okay. So figure A shows the circuit of capacitor coupled non-inverting amplifier using a single polarity. So I have a single polarity here, which means I'm going to give input only to one of the terminals. And here again, the voltage divider constituted by R1 and R2 biases the op-amp non-inverting input terminal at VCC by 2. So this concept is very much clear for us, and we are just revisiting this in a different configuration. Okay, so VCC by 2 is important. The bottom of resistor R4, okay, now you have R4 here. So this is a different configuration here. R4 is capacitor coupled to ground via C3. So in fact, I can connect it directly to ground, but then in order to make the circuit more stable, what I do is I connect it to a capacitor C3, and from C3 it is actually grounded. Now if in case I directly ground, then what is going to be the impact? Okay, so that is what I have mentioned here. If this point was directly grounded, the DC voltage at the op-amp terminal would be towards ACL into VCC by 2. Okay, if in case the resistor R4 here is directly grounded, then what is going to be the impact? So the impact is going to be that, you know, the output terminal would actually move towards ACL into VCC by 2. So we actually do not need this kind, right? We want the output levels to be as good or as equivalent to the input. So we do not want it to be very much dependent on, you know, ACL, the multiplying factor, right? ACL and VCC by 2. So this is nothing but called ACL into bias level at the non-inverting input. Okay, bias level at the non-inverting input. So ACL into VCC by 2. Now, why is it VCC by 2? Because I'm giving my, you know, VCC here, and then at this point, it's going to be VCC by 2. So this level at the inverting terminal is also going to be VCC by 2. And if I have to calculate the outputs here, okay, so if I do not want that to be dependent, so what I do is I connect it to a capacitor. See, usually capacitors are included so that it filters out, so that, you know, noises are filtered and we get a smooth output. So this output is saturated at approximately VCC minus 1 volts. So whatever output that I'm getting is approximately going to be minus 1 volt with this configuration. Okay, with this configuration. Now we will look at the capacitors, how to actually design these capacitors. With C3 in the circuit, okay, as shown, so C3 we have it here, as shown, and R3 connecting the inverting, R3 connecting the inverting terminal, okay, to the output, the op-amp behaves as a DC voltage follower. Okay, so I have C3, I have R3, and this is actually connecting. So it is partly, you know, this circuit is partly working as a voltage follower. Okay, why is it voltage follower? Because it's a non-inverting configuration, right? So if it's a non-inverting configuration, which means whatever I'm giving to the input, the same thing is going to come at the output. So it's as good as my voltage follower, right? Okay. So the DC voltage level at the op-amp output terminal is the same as that of non-inverting input. So we have seen this already, right? So whatever is going to be here, okay, whatever is going to be here is also going to be same here and also going to be same at this point, okay? So at these three points, it tries to maintain, you know, the same levels of voltages. So that's the specialty of op-amp, right? Okay, for AC voltages, this C3 behaves as a short circuit. Okay, so if I'm giving AC voltages, then it's going to be like a short circuit. So it is going to directly get connected. So that the AC voltage gain, okay, the gain is now not dependent. Okay, it is not dependent, but then the gain is going to have a different formula, which is R3 plus R4 divided by R4, because this is going to be a short, right? So it is as good as C3 is non-existent. So it is very much going to be dependent on R3 plus R4 divided by R4. Okay, so again, this is important here. Fine. So how do we calculate C1, C2, R1 and R2? So as we have seen for voltage follower, right, the same way it is calculated. So C1, it is taken like R1 in parallel with R2, right? And that value is divided by 10 at frequency F1, isn't it? And similarly for C2, okay, C2 will be taken with respect to RL, okay? And similarly, R1 and R2 are calculated based on the currents, okay? R3 and R4, now these two resistors are determined in the usual way for non-inverting amplifier. So we see the normal non-inverting amplifier without this capacitor coupled, right? So we are going to use the same formula for designing R3 and R4. ओके नाउ कैपेसिटर C3 should be selected to have an impedance very much smaller. So C3's impedance, now there is a condition here. I cannot have C3's impedance much larger than R4, but then this C3 is actually being a support to R4. So which means the impedance of C3 should be subordinate. What I'm trying to say here is C3 should be a subordinate to R4. It can never overcome R4, the impedance of R4. So which means if it tries to have a greater impedance than R4, then it is as good as having another resistor connected here. I do not want another resistor. I just need certain amount of impedance. Okay. Why is this done? So that, you know, it doesn't get multiplied with the bias current. Okay. ACL into the bias current. So I do not want that. So instead, I am grounding this capacitor via C3. So C3's impedance, I'm trying to make it as minimal as possible. Okay, so C3 is going to be R4 divided by 10. So you can see here, we had used this formula for designing which coupling capacitor. Can someone tell me? This formula we had used for designing which coupling capacitor. Was it for C1 or is it for C2? For which one had we used this formula? R4 divided by 10, or resistance, let's take it as general, resistance divided by 10. So where have we seen this for designing C1 or C2? Yeah, students.
C2
we had taken with respect to RL, right? So C1 actually we had taken in this format, right? The resistance value divided by 10. Remember, we had taken R1, R2 parallel. So I get a value of resistance, yes, there, right? So that value of resistance was divided by 10. So here also, you know, I'm going to take R3 and R4, because here also it's acting like a voltage divider here. R3 and R4, and specifically, okay, since there's a junction forming here, and R4, I want to connect it to ground directly, and I'm just having a small, I need to have a small impedance here, okay? So what I do is, you can see that it is, you know, 1/10 the value of R4, so which means it is very minimal. Now, if I need to have an alternative, okay, say I do not want to have this formula, okay, I need to have an alternative design. So how do I do it? So one alternative is to have C3 determine the lower cutoff frequency. So from where, which band of frequencies I am interested, up to, you know, what is going to be the maximum. So here I'm interested in the lower cutoff frequency, which could be desirable for a circuit that has a variable load. So when I say variable load, it means that, you know, we can change, we can increase or decrease the amount of load. So in this situation, I should be knowing the starting point of my frequency, the cutoff, right? The starting point. So here, XC3, so I can make XC3 is equal to R4 at F1. But I have to change XC2. Okay, I have to change XC2. So XC2 is going to be RL minimum divided by 10. So it is just like this, you know, I can make 3 plus 7 is equal to 10, or I can make 4 plus 6 is equal to 10. So if I increase one side, I have to decrease the other side, right? So here, if I'm increasing, okay, I have to make sure that here I'm going to decrease, and this will be with respect to RL, and this capacitor here C3 will be with respect to R4. Okay. So I hope this concept is clear, students. Any doubts? Any doubts?
No, sir.
You will have to remember the circuits, right? You will have to remember, you know, how to calculate the formulas, okay? Which formula I'm going to use? Am I using this formula or am I going to use this kind of arrangement? So you have to decide how you're going to do. So if in case you're having a larger capacitor here, then you should have a smaller capacitor. So to do that, it should be 1/10 of RL. And C1, anyway, we are taking a parallel combination, and to that value of resistance, we are dividing by 10, right? So resistance and capacitance values should be, you know, indirectly proportional. Okay, so which means resistor values will be high, capacitor values will be low. Capacitor, if in case capacitor values are high, then I need to make the resistance values to be low. Okay. So based on whatever learnings that we have done, okay, learning and whatever findings that we have done so far, you know, calculating the value of resistance, capacitance. So we will put them all together here and we'll solve an example where it is needed to design an op-amp. Okay. So the capacitor coupled non-inverting amplifier in figure A. So I have brought the figure A here. Is to have the following. So there are some specifications, as I always mention, right? Try to extract some data from the question, right? So most of your problem, majority of your problem will be solved if you're good at extracting data from the question itself. So I have all this, right? VCC is there, ACL is there, peak to peak, F1, how much it is to be, and RL, how much I need to have. Okay, so they are telling me to use a 741 op-amp. So which means you should be sticking with the specifications of 741. So you need to see the charts of 741. So the I2 value, so we have seen I2 is very much greater than IB max. So we have seen here that, you know, we usually take 100 times of IB max, and this IB, we get it from the data sheet, which is about 50 microamperes, right? So few values, maybe those known values for 741, you can just make note, and, you know, like 500 nanoamps and this 50, you know, 50 microamps, so all this, you know, you can just make note in one side and just before your examination, that is going to be helpful. And the formulas as well. Right, so 100 times of IB max, which is equal to about 50 microamps, right? So let us just 50 nano yeah, so 500 nano, right? IB max used to be about 500 nano. So if you multiply this 500 nano into 100, you should be getting about 50 microamps. So are you all getting that? Please check. So what values are you going to multiply 100 with IB max? What's the value for IB max? Based on our charts. The data sheet for 741. So IB max is going to be how much, students? Are you all with me?
Yes. 474K.
No, for I2. For I2, are we getting 50 microamps? IB max, what is the value for IB max now, students? Tell me. We have solved in previous problems also, and I have mentioned it just now. IB max is how much? It is 500 nanoamps. Okay, so multiply 500 nanoamps with 100 and tell me if you're getting about 50 micro.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now we know that, you know, this R1 and R2, you know, is going to give us values, which is, you know, V is IR. So V, I know it's going to be VCC by 2 because it is, you know, voltage divider configuration. So VCC by 2 divided by I2. I2 I have and VCC by 2. So VCC, they have told us to use 24. So 24 by 2. How much are we getting?
6.
Are we getting 240? 240 kilo ohms are we getting?
Yes, sir.
This one, 240, right? So we are getting exactly 240, but then we will not be using that. We'll be using about 220 kilo ohms. But in case of capacitors, what do? Do we choose a higher value or a lower value? Yeah. Now, in case of resistor, I'm choosing a lower standard value, right? So in case of capacitor, we will be choosing a little higher standard value. Whatever is the calculated values, we're going to take a little higher than that. Okay. Now the input voltage. Okay. So the input voltage, we know that, you know, it is about, you know, V0 by ACL. Okay. V0 is to be about 5 volts. And this ACL also, we know that it is 100. So if you can divide them, are we getting about 50? 5 divided by 100. Yes, are we getting 50 milli?
Yes.
Fine. Now, similarly, I4, okay? I4 is with respect to R4. I4 is much greater than IB. So what I will do, I4 is equal to IB max 100 into IB max. So I'm going to use the same value here, you know, which is about 50 microns, right? So R4, how do I calculate R4? VI divided by I4. Now, why am I using VI? Because I know that whatever is there at the non-inverting terminal, the same thing will be at my inverting terminal. I have calculated here already. So this 50 also, I will bring it down here. And I4 value I already have here. Okay, so which means I should be getting about 1 kilo ohms. Are we getting that? One K. Are we getting? Milli is 10 raised to 3, micro 10 raised to 6. So 6 and 3. It's cancelled. So we are left out with 3, which is K. Okay. Now R3 plus R4, okay, this R3 plus R4 is equal to whatever output that I am getting divided by current I4. So I have 5 and 50, right? So are we getting 100 kilo ohms, students? Please calculate. Along with you, even I'm doing the calculations. Are we getting 100? Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Next, R3. Okay, R3 is equal to R3 plus R4 minus R4. So it is like plus R4 minus R4, and I'm left out with R3. So what I'll do here is, I know that this R3 plus R4 is going to be about 100. Okay, so I have this here already, R3 plus R4, 100K minus R4. Okay, R4 value. Have they given us R4 value? Somewhere we had found out, yeah, R4 is here. So it is 1K. So 100 minus 1K. So I'm going to have 99K. So 99K is not standard. So I'm going to use 100K as a standard. So we have the formula for capacitance, 1 divided by 2 pi f. Now see this combination, R1, R2 parallel divided by 10, right? So I'm going to use that. So 2 pi f, frequency 75, I'm substituting the same. And 220, R1, R2 is also 220 divided by 10. So we should be getting about 0.2 microfarad. So you can see that, you know, C2 I am calculating with respect to RL. So C2, if I'm taking a small resistance, I told you previously when we were calculating, right? When we were learning about the concept, if C2 is taken as, you know, a smaller value, then C3 is going to be with as equivalent as R4. I'm not going to take R4 divided by 10. Okay, so C3 is going to be equivalent to R4. What is this equivalent? The impedance of C3 is going to be equivalent to R4. So C2 also, I will substitute the values, right? RL is already given to us to be about 5.6. So I should be getting 3.8. Now see, here also, I am using a standard value, a higher standard value. Okay, fine. Now here also it is higher. You might ask, sir, 99 also is low and this 100 is higher. It is just 1K. So it's not going to matter. You take this example here where 240 and we're using 220. We have reduced here drastically. So again, if I reduce here, my circuit property itself is going to change. So instead, I'm going to use the closest available standard value, which is 100 instead of 99. Now C3, 1 by 2 pi FR. So R C3 is dependent with R4, right? So 1 by 2 pi F into R4. So R4 is 1K. Ultimately, I should be getting about 2.12 microfarads. So now if I have to calculate my total gain, okay, if I have to calculate my total gain, it is nothing but dependent with R4 plus R1, R2 in parallel divided by R1, R2. So this formula is important, right? Where our gain is dependent on R1, R2, and R4. Okay. So R4, why? Because it's directly getting connected to the ground. R3 is with the feedback loop here, right? And R1, R2 is actually deciding how much of input is getting inside the op-amp. Fine, students. Any doubts here? Any doubts?
No, sir.